Hi, I'm Dhukhilan, and I was a member of the 2010 Youth Olympic Games men football team. I started when I was really young. I can remember when I just started walking and my mom bought me a ball and I just went down and started kicking. And then from that moment on, she knew that, you know, I was really into football. And when I started seriously considering football was when I was in primary school, primary 4 and about primary 4. We were playing during recess time, me and some of the boys, and our teacher at that time, Mr. Chun from North Spring Primary School, he saw us playing and he thought like, okay, you know, why not? Let's just create a football team, since the school it was a rather new school, so they didn't have a football team back then. So that's how I started playing seriously in the North Zone. I played as a striker, and in Primary 5 and Primary 6, I became the top scorer for the North Zone. And yeah, and from that moment on, I told myself that I really wanted to become a footballer. I can clearly remember watching the news with my family, and then there was like a open call for the YOG trials. They said that they were going to have an open trial to select players to play in the Youth Olympic Games. So my sister and I thought, you know, initially I was quite skeptical to go for it because wasn't sure about my abilities. Then my sister believed in me, and she was the one who brought me down for the open trials. And I remember going there thinking how to do it, because there was 900 players in that open trial. So I told myself that I have to take it day by day. The whole selection period took about 3 years, from 2008 all the way to the final 21 in 2010, just before the Youth Olympic Games. In that 3 years, we had the Asian Youth Games where 21 of us were selected to play against Iran and Thailand. That tournament was a wake-up call because we knew our standard, where we were against our counterparts. So that was a disappointing tournament for me, because I personally, on a individual note, I didn't play as well as I wanted to. But you know, I told myself that this was just a warm-up, so I continued, you know, pushing forward and didn't want to lose my place in the final 21. And I had to skip schools on some days because I finished training about 10 plus at sports school, and I had to rush back home, finish my homework. So mornings I would, you know, on some days, my friends used to call me the Ponting Kid, because I would miss school just to go down for trainings. And yeah, that was I knew I really wanted to get into the Youth Olympic Games, and also thankful for my family support, because normally, you know, families they really focus on your studies come first. But my family told me that, you know, studies, they will always be there for you, but Youth Olympic Games is only once in a lifetime, so you know, just go for it. And till today, I'm really thankful for that. Kadir was very strict. He was a disciplinarian. He very regimented in his way of things. And I'm one of the lucky few, I would say, to be coached under him, because he was just football crazy. That's all I can remember. But the thing that no one knows about him, he always had a soft side for his players. He was very strict on all of us, but he always cared for us. There were times where we couldn't turn up for training because we were behind in our studies, we were falling, our grades was going down. So he always made it a point to follow up with the HODs in the schools And he always, there was times where he left training halfway to go down to our school to make sure that we are there in class. And on the pitch, he was just a total different person, you know. He would be very precise, he's very detailed with his drills. And off the pitch, when we were in hotel rooms and everything, he would stay inside his room throughout the day studying about Ajax, Barcelona, how they played, how they always maintained their triangles. And he made sure we followed the same. He would give us homework. He had to write down notes on how certain players play. Like, for example, Amirul Imran was our centre mid. I remember him making sure that he played like Xavi and Iniesta. You know, how they moved, how they turned their head, every single thing, how they made their passes, the technique. And for centre backs, how we have to play, like PK, awareness and all that kind of thing. So he really made us love football. He made the team very drilled, you know, in a sense where we knew where our teammates would run to without even looking at them. So that gave us an edge in the Youth Olympic Games because we were able to play fast football. So yeah, a lot of people, you know, Kadir is one coach that ranks very highly in Singapore football in that sense because he's really passionate about football and he translates it to his players as well. I think it was the connection with the fans, with Singaporeans and our team, how they came out in full force to support us, to, you know, you see stadiums being filled up and everything. There was an instant, Singaporeans felt the sense of belonging in the stadium when they are there supporting us. We were able to bring a good brand of football. We were also able to bring a diverse team. There was Indians, Malays, Chinese, Eurasians in our squad. And Singaporeans that came down, you know, they just brushed their differences aside and they came down to watch football. And we were also able to repay their faith by playing a good brand of football. So there was this instant connection that the team and also the fans felt. And we were given nicknames like the Cubs, and fans climbed up on top car parks just to watch us play. Tickets were sold out in just a few hours. And, you know, you don't really see this much often in Singapore football. You know, the Malaysia Cup teams, they had it. You know, Tiger Cup teams, they also had it. So I think the fact that after the Tiger Cup, you know, Singaporeans felt that, you know, this team could be the next team that, you know, they can watch and grow. Also the fact that we were young. And yeah, that struck me most for throughout the whole YOG, the connection we had with the fans. We had various ministers. We had our Prime Minister, Lee Hsien Loong, and also our late President, S.R. Nathan, who came down for our matches. You know, it shows how much support we had, and we also felt that we couldn't let down the nation because of the support they've all of the ministers and also the fans that gave us at that time. I actually came across it on Facebook. One of my ex-team psychologists, Sanjana, she posted it. And I thought, you know what, you know, let's just give it a go. Because at that time, I retired from football. It was last year. And I thought, I still have the ability to contribute to football, but in a different way. So I gave it a go. They had about a month course. And I went through the course and with the selections and everything. So I made it to the final 25. It's a 4-year course. We will get seed funding to roll out our projects. and use sport as an empowerment tool. So my project will consist various parts to it. There will be physical part to it and also a mental part to it. The physical part will be about football, using football as a empowerment tool for kids with disabilities and also for women to take it as a leadership tool. And also the mental part is in terms of workshops and various programs with industry leaders to share their experience, to have an industry collaboration. And yeah, this will be my short-term goal for the next 4 years in the program. And in my long-term goal, I hope to achieve, hope to set up academies where people fund it for kids who don't have the money to join academies. I do believe that these kids have the talent, just that they don't have the platform to do so. And yeah, that's my long-term goal. Growing up, I was never the first kid to be selected for any team, be it football or studies. It's always the one of the last few. And I think that pushed me to always try and go beyond, to always try and be one of the top few guys. Because growing up, I hated the feeling of being the last few. And football had given me this opportunity to build myself resilience and my determination and my inner power. So I was thankful enough for that. And now moving forward, I feel that I have the right and the ability to give it back to these kids who might feel the same as me, who might feel that they are always one of the last few. So I intend to use football and my ability to empower them, to give them this leadership strength to always go beyond and to always push themselves and never settle for anything less.